I'll talk about mock simulations on Earth, and I want to give a short overview of past and future missions. First, I want to introduce the simulations on Earth, and then I want to talk about Mars 500. You've already heard about it, I think. And then I want to talk about the Mars and the research stations of the Mars Society. And then, at last, I want to talk about planned future missions for next year. What are Mars simulations on Earth? They are simulations of planned Mars missions. They simulate partly only parts of such a mission, or a whole mission duration. For example, 500 days. And they simulate such a mission in laboratories, in simulated spacecrafts, make auto missions in spacesuits and test them and such a technology. They make missions in caves. And they build habitats at Mars like Terran, or climate on Earth, like in deserts or polar deserts. In my opinion, the Mars mission is the next step for the human exploration of the solar system. The Mars is the most Earth-like planet in our solar system, and it's our neighbor. Here are facts about Mars. Some facts. We never did such a mission, so we have to simulate it first on Earth to look after the procedures and test them to prepare our astronauts. What are the challenges of a manned Mars mission? First of all, the physical effects of exposure to high energy cosmic rays and other ionizing radiation. You can't simulate it really on Earth. You get no volunteers. Then the physical effects of a prolonged low gravity environment, including eyesight loss. That you can simulate it on ISS in long-term missions. This challenge you can simulate in a limited limited way. The psychological effects of a lack of immunity due to lack of real-time connections with Earth that was tested in Mars 500, for example. Then the social effects of several humans living under crowded conditions for over one Earth year that was also tested at the Mars 500 simulation. And inaccessibility of terrestrial medical facilities. On a spacecraft traveling to Mars, you have no emergency exit or a hospital in your neighborhood. Who does it? First of all, space agencies like NASA, ESA, the German space agency, Roscosmos, and the Chinese National Space Agency. But there are also private initiatives like the Mars Society or the Austrian Space Forum. You saw the video already. The OAWF. So now I come to the Mars 500 mission, which ended last year. It was a simulation conducted by Roscosmos, ESA, DLR, and the Chinese Space Agency. It was a simulated manned Mars mission for a total duration of 520 days. There were six men in a simulated spacecraft traveling 250 days to Mars, then conducted a 30 days Mars exploration, three crew members, and then returned to Earth in a 240 days. And it was conducted in, from the 3rd June 2010 to 4th November 2011, 1 year ago, it ended. It was a psychosocial isolation experiment, and they studied the technical challenge, the work capability of crew, and the management of long-distance spaceflight. So now come to the facility. It was located at the Institute of Biomedical Studies in Moscow. And here you can see a 3D model. We have the habitable module with six individual compartments for the crew, the kitchen, laboratory, and so on. A medical module, a utility module, with a gym, a greenhouse, a thermal chamber, and so on. And they had also, for the Mars exploration, a lander module, or a ship, or a lander ship. And they had a simulated Martian surface, where they could make an EVA for the 30 days of the Mars exploration. What were the scientific objectives of Mars 500? First of all, they they tested the methods and the means of control and monitoring of the habitat during such a long crew stay in this confined and cramped condition. They tested the planning diagnostics, made forecasts and treatments, also managed support and prophylaxis, tested or examined the use of telemedicine technologies, tested also countermeasures against adverse effects of the flight factors on the human body. Tested psychological support and created a reporting system for the activity of the crew and for the information. And they had all over the facility cameras installed. And it was like a big brother to observe the activities of the crew. The simulated characteristics of the flight were the communication lag from 8 seconds to 20 minutes. on flight day 351. And they had, for example, 1 week without communications at all. And they observed the reactions of the astronauts. The crew lived and worked like astronauts on the International Space Station. They made maintenance work, scientific experiments, and daily exercises. The rations were, the resources were rationed. The facility was hermetically closed, and the environment was confined. What were the results of this mission? first of all, the selected crew worked very well and surprisingly harmonic together. Nobody was excluded from the crew. They had one problem, the growth of biofilms inside the isolated spacecraft, and this could be a problem for long-term space missions. For example, it could come to infections or malfunctions of the equipment. The scientists observed changes in the immune system of the simulating astronauts, like on the International Space Station, caused by the stress and isolation. The salt balance in the human body is much more complex as previously thought, because the astronauts got a special diet, and so they could make studies about this salt balance. But officials said, yes, we're ready to go to Mars. But there are also critics and constraints of the simulation. They couldn't simulate the microgravity and also neither the radiation. The facility stood still on Earth and was not millions of kilometers away. And they had an emergency exit. You can't really simulate this here on Earth. And the crew members were all male. You could think about sending only small women to Mars, because they weigh not so much and they don't eat so much. Now to the next topic, the Mars Analog Research Stations. They were built and are maintained by the Mars Society in the US. They are prototypes of Mars habitats, and they, the Mars Society will want to test protocols and procedures for human operations on Mars, and wants to test equipment like spacesuits or Mars cars and so on for later space Mars missions. They planned four Mars habitats, but there were only two were built. One of them is the Flashline Mars Arctic Research Station in on Devon Island in Canada, and it's operational since 2000. Then there is a Mars Desert Research Station in Thousand Utah in the desert. And it's operational since 2002. There was also it's also planned the European Mars Analog Research Station, but it was built, during the shipment, it was destroyed. And now we need funding for a new habitat, and also for the Australian Mars Analog Research Station, or MASMOS. It's also planned, but not built yet because of the lack of funding. What are the key questions for these missions at this habitat? What is the best number for an exploratory team on Mars? Four people, six people, or more? How well do support systems and equipment function in the field? What are the best designs for an EVA suit? And how easy is it to maintain equipment in such isolated conditions for the mission engineer? And how are the tube dynamics going to operate in such a closed environment? Now we come to the crew. The crew contains of volunteers. They pay for their stay at the habitat. And it's a mix of astronomers, physicists, biologists, geologists, engineers, and sometimes journalists for public outreach. They have a command structure, like on a real Mars mission. You could say a commander, an executive officer, a health and safety officer, and a group biologist, a crew geologist, and a chief engineer. As the Mars Desert Research Stations were already 100 crews in 2 week shifts since 2002. At the FMAR, Flashline Mars Analog Research Stations, were only 12 crews. Now I come to the layout of the Mars Habitat units. There are two deck units that have a common layout. It's a cylinder with this and it fits in a Saturn V rocket, or it would fit if you had one. In the habitat are crew cabins, a kitchen, dining area, laboratory, engineering area, hygiene area, airlocks, exercise area, and the flashline at Devon Island. And here you can see a 3D model. This is the upper deck, and this is the lower deck. And it's actually the Mars Desert Research Station. And here's a human. Okay. The MDRS has additional features. There is a greenhouse connected to the habitat over the airlock. And they can grow carrots, radishes, tomatoes, and other vegetables. And they have gray water recycling inside of the greenhouse. Then there's a Mars Desert Observatory with a Schmidt K-spring telescope, which can be remote controlled over the internet by amateur astronomers or professionals. And at the site of the Mars Desert Research Station, is since 2007 the University Robo Challenge. So now I come to future missions. You've already seen in the video from the Austrian Space Forum. And next year, will be the Morocco 2013 Mars Analog Field Simulation conducted by the Austrian Space Forum and other international partners.
Simulation will be in the north of Sahara in Morocco.
Here, a quick picture from Google Earth. There's Spain, and there's Morocco. The mission is part of the interdisciplinary research program of the Austrian Space Forum, and is an analog simulation research program for human-robot interaction. The research will be to study the equipment behavior, the human-robotic interaction. They've built two spacesuits simulators, Aguda X. You saw it already in the video. Here's a picture of it. It's 45 kilogram heavy. And it's not pressurized or something, but they have onboard data handling system on board, and speech recognition inside of it. They've also four rovers and some landers. Here are two examples of them. Cool approach, I think. And the simulation would be a platform for testing life detection methods, for testing geophysical techniques, and terrain tests. And they will do terrain tests for the rovers. And they will want to use it for the public outreach of a Mars mission. Here you can see a picture from Viking of the Martian landscape. And here is of the region where the simulation will be next year.
So Viking landed in Morocco?
Yeah.
Yeah, conspiracy.
So now, the next mission next year is the Hawaii Space Exploration Element simulation, funded by the NASA, and it's located at the Mauna Loa on Hawaii. It will durate 120 days, and they've also they've already chosen their six astronauts. And the research focus will be new forms of food and food preparation. And they wanted to develop new recipes of the storable food, and wanted to examine the reactions of the crew on this food in a physically and psychological way. That's the end. Thank you for your attention, and let's go to Mars. Are there any questions?
Are there questions?
Did you go to the Earth?
No.
Would you like to?
Yes.
What is stopping you?
What?
What is stopping you? What is stopping you, preventing you?
They want, I think, for students, $500 for the transportation and so on, and that stops me here.
Okay, it's okay.
Any further questions?
There are many media films and so on where they describe Mars landings and Mars colonies. Is it? Can you compare that to the reality, or is it really complete fantasy, like Mission for Mars or something like that? I don't know if you've seen that film, but there are also books and other media where they describe the stations on Mars. And my question is, is it really complete fantasy, or are there the guys who wrote the book or create the film, are they not so much far away from the reality?
Yes, it's science fiction, but there are some two points in it, I think, in this this film or books.
For example, John Carter was partly taken next to Antares, so the filming was done there, and the physics actually in the movie are pretty good, in terms of him jumping around, if you see.
And for example, Mission to Mars is one of the better ones, besides the last ending, because that's really alien. But I think they could use the NASA insignia, and for example, Red Planet, the action-oriented planet colonization thingy, where the robot goes amok, they couldn't use it because NASA said, oh, no, that's too much, we couldn't support you. But I think for Mission to Mars, they had a contact person at NASA, and they had some advice, okay, it's film. They have to be exciting and so on, but there are better ones and not so good ones. Okay, I have another question. You had an example of the mission structure, like the executive person and the safety and so on. Are they also dually trained? That, for example, the commander can also be a nurse, because when the real medicine man will be not available because he's whatever, then there should be a lot of redundancy for bad situations. Is it also for this?
You have to bring such a what's called. If you want to be a commander, you have to already been on a mission earlier.
So he's also trained for something besides doing the okay that direction. Please go and hurry. So he's also able to do some of the tasks the other crew members are normally doing. Oh, great. Because in case, like you said before, there is no emergency hospital in the near area, so they should have at least some basic knowledge about, hey, your leg is missing, we have to bandage it and stuff.
There are actually written procedures for the chief medical officer. They are also in contact with, supported by a flight surgeon. And yes, we had a few occurrences where the executive officer was also chief medical officer.
Great. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much, Nikolai. We will now switch to the next presentation. Okay, we have some time.